Welcome. My name is Dr. Michelle Albert, and I am the current president of the Association of Black Cardiologists. I want to thank you for joining us for this, our fifth ABC webinar about COVID-19, entitled Following the Murmurs of COVID-19 in Diverse Populations. In some respects, we have come a long way from April 8th, 2020, when we, ABC as an organization, were one of the first voices to highlight the COVID-19 syndemic among African Americans. It is important to note that a syndemic refers to the interaction between disease concentration and interactions which exacerbate social inequities. In fact, although we refer to COVID-19 as a pandemic in general, which it is, for minority communities such as African Americans, Hispanic Americans, and indigenous populations, it is a syndemic. Where have we been? Unfortunately, the statistics have been grim. One in 555 African Americans have died. One in 330 indigenous Americans have died. One in 565 Pacific Islanders have died. One in 680 Hispanics or Latinos have died. One in 665 whites have died. And one in 1,040 Asian Americans have died. Not to mention the countless persons who were hospitalized. Today, we honor their lives. As we look towards the future, we want to reflect on the term murmur. Murmur, for all of us in medicine, we know that it is an atypical sound of the heart, typically indicating a functional or structural abnormality as defined by the Merriam-Webster dictionary. MedicineNet defines a murmur as a sound due to vibrations from the flow of blood through the heart or great vessels. A murmur may be innocent and may be of no significance, or it may be pathologic and reflect disease. A murmur, as we all know, is usually heard with a stethoscope. So as we embark on this program following the murmurs of COVID-19, despite the development of highly efficacious COVID-19 vaccines, disproportionate vaccine hesitancy within the African community persists. Indeed, as of May 17, 2020, at least one dose of the COVID vaccine has gone only to 27% of Black individuals, 31% of Latino and Indigenous individuals, 41% of white persons, and 55% of Asian Americans. We do know that 50% of the US population approximately as of yesterday have been vaccinated overall. We also have to look towards the murmurs of long hauler syndrome that have pathogenic cardiovascular disease whispers. In terms of the psychosocial determinants, we also have to deal with the murmurs of emotional well-being, including depression and anxiety in patients who have suffered from COVID-19 and their family members, disproportionate unemployment and financial vibrations in the African-American and Hispanic and Latino communities. In a bright spot, we are excited today, though, to highlight the work of three of our six COVID-19 Innovation Award winners, and to bring our very own Dr. Peter Chin Hong, who you'll hear more about in a little bit, who has been a leader in the trenches with us from our very first COVID-19 webinar. And today, I really would like to salute Dr. Chin Hong. And also, we bring to you as another invited speaker, Dr. Carlos Del Rios, a dear friend to ABC from Emory University. I will be reading brief bios of all speakers prior to your presentations. But before we begin, I also want to state that ABC stands up against hate in all of its forms. Indeed, reflecting on our first webinar on April 8th, 2020, which was Zoom bombed by racists spewing hate messages to us, to those of us who were participating in that webinar. That was a very jarring experience. We reflect and ask for a moment of silence on the anniversary of George Floyd's murder to remember members of our community lost to hate. So let's take a moment of silence. We also continue to take a stand against hate and violence perpetuated against the Asian community, who are also our family, in the struggle against racism. There is absolutely no place for hate in our world. And we must love each other. To quote Maya Angelou, begin quote, love recognizes no barriers. It jumps hurdles, leaps fences, penetrates walls to arrive at its destination, full of hope, end quote. So it is with hope I present to you Dr. Peter Chin Hong. Dr. Chin Hong is a professor of medicine at UCSF School of Medicine. He is a vibrant and well-endowed teaching scholar at UCSF. He has won numerous teaching awards. He's the medical he's a medical educator who specializes in treating infectious diseases, particularly infections that develop in persons who have suppressed immune systems, such as solid organ and hematopoietic stem cell transplant recipients and HIV organ transplant recipients. He directs the immunocompromised host diseases program at UCSF. He earned his undergraduate medical degree at Brown University and completed his residency in internal medicine and infectious disease fellowship at UCSF. He's also the director of the year-long inquiry program in the School of Medicine. He's the inaugural holder of the Academy of Medical Educators Endowed Chair for Innovation in Teaching. Welcome, Dr. Chin Hong.
Thanks so much, Dr. Albert, for those very kind words. And also the opening statement, quoting Maya Angelou, I think it's so meaningful to all of us in the Asian community, as well as all minority populations, to really feel the repercussions of all this violence and hate during the past year. So right now, I'm just going to share my slides. So today I'm going to speak about just some vaccine and masking updates. Dr. Del Rio will focus more on the epidemiology, but I'll also spend a little time speaking about where we are in terms of vaccines. So this is the outline. We will first talk about vaccines, mainly spending a little time on epidemiology. I'll highlight some updates in equity, focusing on where we are around the world, efficacy updates, as well as some adverse effects updates. And then I'll turn my attention briefly to some updates in masking and where the CDC has made statements and whether or not it will be still safe for us to go around unmasked as vaccinated individuals, specifically making comments on immunocompromised individuals and individuals under kids under 12 who haven't been able to get vaccinated yet because it hasn't had emergency use authorization. So let's start with a few words on epidemiology. So there's still a lot of variable administration in the United States. I think we focus on this number of 50% vaccinated, but you can see that there are a lot of regional differences in where vaccinations have gone. From California, New York, around 50%, to a lot of in the light green colors, almost white, 35% Idaho, and a lot of low numbers in the southern states. Some of it may be due to politics for sure. And this analysis from the New York Times really attests to that. First of all, showing you what which states are more likely to have a higher proportion of their population vaccinated with proportion of residents given at least one shot on the y-axis. And who basically states voted for on the x-axis. Part of that seems to be due to politics, but really it's probably more complex than that. And a lot of it has to do with vaccine hesitancy as well, which again takes myriad shapes, even regardless of who you voted for. But when we look globally, the disparities are even starker. And you can see that again, with the US hovering around 50%, we have Mexico at 10%, Argentina at 13%, South Africa at 1%, India at 7%, China at 19%. And with some of the most vaccinated countries, Chile at 46%, UK, Israel, of course, the poster child of vaccine rollout, and the Seychelles coming in close to 70%. Notice these numbers of Chile and Seychelles. We'll come back to them because they've been having outbreaks right now, despite having these high vaccination rates. So let's talk a little bit about equity. And I thought today I would focus more on global equity. Having had the last few talks devoted to domestic and equity within our own country. So essentially, when we think about vaccines around the world, we think simply of supply and demand. There's not enough supply right now, and we are threatened by not enough demand, even if we have the supply around the world. Vaccine hesitancy is not just a US phenomenon, it's a global phenomenon. So of course, it comes as no surprise that the highest income countries are getting vaccinated at a rate of 25 times more. And this graphic really illustrates that the wealthiest 27 places have about 30% of the vaccinations, but 10% of the world's population. The US has prepaid for 1.2 billion vaccines with the idea that maybe some of the vaccines in Operation Warp Speed wouldn't work, but of course, all of them have proven to be quite effective, particularly in the outcome we care most about, preventing severe disease, hospitalizations, and death. So what can the others do and the US? To summarize, we can donate more vaccines. Certainly we've pledged about 80 million doses right now. We can fund vaccine efforts globally, like in COVAX, although that has been stymied by the Indian Serum Institute not being able to produce or deliver as much to the global effort because of what's happening in India right now. The third thing we can do is expand manufacturing. And of course, we've enacted a Defense Production Act to enable us to give raw materials. And we can also, of course, support the waiving of patents. But the patent is only as good as giving the technical support needed with the recipe. So in other words, you can give the recipe for the cheesecake, but if it's a really complex cheesecake, you need to give the cook and the raw materials for the cheesecake as well. But you can see in the last column, there's still more, a lot more that we can do. So I think I was really surprised to see that, well, maybe it's not surprising that vaccine hesitancy is a global phenomenon. You know, structural racism is not just a US issue, it's all around the world. Minority populations are everywhere. And when you delve into this data some more, I think much of the same themes persist: distrust of government, tramping down on minority populations, et cetera. And even in my own country and part of the world, Jamaica, Trinidad, they're around 30% vaccine acceptance. And that's really shocking to me. It really speaks to the fact that people are not, are being very mistrustful. Even globally, because of all the discussion that's been happening. And Trinidadians and people in the Caribbean are not averse to vaccines in general. Getting childhood vaccines is really a part of the way of life for us. So it's even starker, this vaccine hesitancy. So some updates quickly on efficacy. Yesterday, the CDC published an MMWR vaccine breakthrough infection snapshot in the United States, essentially very, very rare, about 0.01% chance of getting a breakthrough infection itself, which is lower than getting struck by lightning, and a 0.0001% chance of dying, which is lower than getting struck by a meteor and dying. So essentially, very low odds, even though, of course, the asymptomatic cases haven't been systematically counted, the CDC is now turning towards focusing only on severe disease, which I think is appropriate. Second update, vaccine efficacy, it still remains if you delay the second dose. Of course, the UK did this because they had no other choice when they were rolling out the vaccine so that as many people as possible can get the vaccines. This was a small study in the UK from Birmingham showing that in 175 older individuals over the age of 80, if you delay the second dose 12 weeks compared to those who received the dose on time, there were actually 3.5 times higher antibodies in the people who delayed the second dose. I'm not really sure what that means, except that it doesn't show decreased efficacy. So in other words, delaying the vaccine dose is probably not bad and potentially even better, even though nobody's probably going to intentionally delay their second dose. Third update, I think we've all been very fearful of the variant first described in India, B.1.617. There's a study in the UK looking at more than 12,000 participants looking at symptomatic disease. You can see that after the first dose, they're only mildly effective against both the B.1.1.7 variant first described in UK in Kent and the B.1.617 variant first described in India. But by the time you give the second dose, particularly with Pfizer, the numbers look pretty good. So all in all, these studies suggest that for right now, at least, we're keeping the variants at bay with the vaccines that we have, but probably not all vaccines are created equal. One quick update on adverse effects. Many of you in the audience might have heard about the myocarditis CDC advisory. Speaking of a few reports of myocarditis following the vaccine, maybe similar to the background rate. It's also been described in Israel with about 62 cases. The EU is looking at it right now. And we see this in other vaccines as well. So not a big surprise to see a bump in troponin if you look for it. Most people resolve. In this advisory from the CDC, most were mild, occurred mainly in adolescents and young adults after the second dose within 4 days, and more males, surprisingly, than females, even though in many of the other adverse effects, even the severe allergic responses, we've seen it more predominant in females. Just to close on a few words on masking, many of you would have heard and reacted to the CDC recommendation a couple of weeks ago about that people who are vaccinated can go without masks indoors and outdoors, except for certain situations like transportation, congregate settings, et cetera. And I think it's met with a lot of initial surprise and fear by others, but jubilation by some. I think we wouldn't have time to go into the nuances of this, but I still think it's a work in progress, particularly when we're seeing this, which is outbreaks in the face of highly vaccinated countries. May mean that not all vaccines are created equal. These countries where there are outbreaks use mainly a mixture of Chinese vaccines, Sinovac and Sinopharm, with AstraZeneca in the case of Seychelles. And we still are waiting for more details, but it could be that the people who are in the outbreak are probably not fully vaccinated, or maybe the fully vaccinated people are not getting severe disease, dying, which is my suspicion. One other group that I think many of us are having more concern about is immunocompromised individuals, not just people who have received solid organ transplants and hematologic malignancies in terms of their response to the vaccines, at least when you look at antibodies. Of course, we're not measuring T cells, but also a whole host of individuals with autoimmune diseases. And as you know, this is enriched by members of minority populations where there's found by studies to have a threefold reduction in titers of antibodies, but not all biologics are created equal. And some of them like Rituxan, et cetera, are much more potent. But steroids surprisingly was also seen to have a decrease in titers, but we don't know what that means in terms of clinical disease. Finally, with under 12 year olds, I think it's really, really tough to advise parents what to do simply because they're not eligible for vaccines yet, and whether or not they would avoid certain areas like crowded areas still or have a mask on is probably going to be the right recommendation to do until this gets EUA approval. I don't have time to show you this really cool TikTok video, but it's about the windmilling that's gone viral as a way to like increase blood supply and diminish the chances of having an adverse effect. Thanks for your attention.
How long is the video, Dr. Chin?
It's probably like one minute. You want me to show it?
Yeah.
Okay, let's try this. Dr. Albert wants to see it. Oops. Yeah, you got me begging, baby, please don't go. If I were, yeah, you got me begging, baby, please. Great, thanks for attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Chin Hung. And again, we at ABC applaud you for your efforts, not just only here in the United States, but working with media outside of the United States around COVID-19 and the effects in the Asian community. And thank you for being in the trenches with us all year long. Our next speaker is Dr. Carlos Del Rio, who is a distinguished professor of medicine in the Division of Infectious Diseases at Emory University School of Medicine and the Executive Associate Dean for Emory at Grady. He's also professor of global health and professor of epidemiology at the Rollins School of Public Health. He's co-director of the Emory Center for AIDS Research and co-PI of the Emory CDC HIV Clinical Trials Unit and Emory Vaccine and Treatment Evaluation Unit. During the COVID pandemic, Dr. Del Rio has been a leader locally and nationally doing research, developing policies, writing scientific publications, and making countless media appearances. We welcome and thank Dr. Del Rio for, again, being a friend of ABC and focusing his presentation on the ongoing epidemiology of COVID-19. Welcome.
Thank you, Michelle, and thank you to the Association of Black Cardiologists for the invitation. As you started, and you rightly said so, I mean, I think that this year we have had a pandemic, but we also have had enormous problems come to light, and violence and racial discrimination and racism that I think just collide with the pandemic and really highlight the importance of addressing the structural issues that are driving the diseases that we're seeing in our country. Can I have the next slide? So these are the numbers of the current epidemic. And the most important thing is to say that, you know, the epidemic is ongoing. Over 3.5 million people have died from this virus already globally. But of the documented deaths, about 50% are in the US, Brazil, India, Mexico, and the UK. The US alone has had over 33 million cases and over 600,000 deaths. And you can see which states there have had more than 1 million cases. But, you know, a year ago, if somebody had said to me, we're going to have over 500,000 deaths in the U.S., I would have said simply impossible. And the fact that we have that is just very, very concerning. You can see India, Brazil as countries that are still having a significant epidemic. And I mentioned this because then you'll see France, Turkey, Russia, and you'll see, you know, Germany, Spain, Argentina, Colombia. And frequently we talk about India as a major issue, but the epidemic is very significant still in Latin America, in Brazil, in Argentina, Colombia, Mexico, and where they're having significant outbreaks and not a lot of vaccines. And the point I'm gonna try to make is that unless we achieve, as Peter said, global equity and get vaccines to everybody, this is not gonna end. The next one. So you can see here the confirmed cases, you know, pretty much stable in every place or coming down like in the US, except for India that had this enormous spike that fortunately is beginning to come down. The next one. But deaths are still rising in India, and over 4,000 people are dying that we know of every day, but the numbers are probably much higher than this. The next one. And as a result of that, you know, even though many of us say, well, the epidemic is over, the reality is globally, it's still over 12,000 people are dying daily. The next one. And in fact, so many people are dying in India that 32.7% of global deaths are now happening there. And this is a catastrophe that is happening in the Indian subcontinent. The next one. And we don't know exactly why this is happening in India, but one of the major issues has been a variant, probably that is the B.1.617 variant that is highly transmissible. And it's probably leading to a lot of the infections that we're seeing, rapidly spreading infections with a lot of, you know, super spreading events, mass gatherings. And you know, part of the cost in India has been, you know, the deaths in healthcare personnel, and over 1,000 physicians have died. And in our country, we have a lot of colleagues that are from Indian origin, have Indian families, and they are having a significant, you know, stress. They're many of them are doing telemedicine with India. Many of them have lost family members. So I just want to mention to everybody, please, you know, keep them in your thoughts, be kind to them, speak to them, because they are having a very difficult time. The next one. So where are we in the US? Well, in the US, we're in a very good place right now, and it's in great part due to vaccines. You know, we're now under 30,000 new cases per day. We're now around 500, you know, deaths per day. So numbers are really coming down in ways that we had never seen before. And in great part is because, you know, we're now about 50% of the US population having had at least one dose of vaccine. The next one. And you can see almost every state, the cases are coming down significantly. The next one. And that huge drop in Michigan is really one that we're all very happy about, because they obviously had a major peak. The next one. So this is the national picture, and you can see, you know, light yellow is best. You want to be under 50 cases per 100,000 population, and only 10 states are there. In the category of sort of light, dark yellow, which is, you know, it's just 50 to 100 cases per 100,000 population, you have a bunch of states. And in the area of over 100 cases, you still have also a large number of states. And I want to remind this to people, because, you know, we are not, we need to get the entire country to be in the light yellow and under 50 cases per 100,000 population. Because if we're not there, then we're really not over this pandemic. The next one. And you can see here that we're getting there, but we still have several counties. We have close to 900 counties that are in the high transmission category. And again, we need to get more and more counties into the yellow or even the blue transmission category. And if we do that, I think we'll be in a better place. So next one. But in general, we're seeing a decrease in cases throughout states, and you can see multiple states here and how the cases are dropping. The next one. And in fact, you know, as this article in New York Times says, the COVID may be on a permanent retreat in the US. And this is, again, in great part due to the efficacy of vaccines. The next one. Now, deaths continue to be an issue, and they're coming down, but we're still having a significant number of deaths. You want to get this, you know, under one death per 100,000 population, which will be the light yellow. And you can see there's still many states that are having around 2 to 5 deaths per 100,000 population. So again, we're not where we need to be. Deaths still need to come down. And this is because people are still not fully vaccinated. The next one. But this looks better. I mean, the country looks better. There's more, no, there's no states currently in the red category, and more states are in the light yellow category. The next one. Hospital admissions are continuing. And again, this is doing better, again, because of vaccines. And you can see in green all the states that have, you know, admissions of 0 to 1 per 100 beds are COVID admissions. And you can see a lot of them are in the green category. Some are in the light yellow, but we still have, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 states that are in the 6 to 10 hospital beds per 100,000 population, including my state of Georgia, where we still have 50, you know, hospitals, you know, 6, 7 admissions per 100,000 population for 100 beds due to COVID. We're still having, you know, next one. I show this, Peter's on the phone. You know, there was this tweet a couple days ago saying, you know, San Francisco General had 0 patients with COVID in the hospital at that point. Well, that same day here at Grady, the next one, we had 25. And that's the difference between more vaccines and less vaccines. The next one. We are seeing an increase in variants, and the predominant variant right now in our country, with close to 78% of cases, is the B.1.1.7. But the vaccine works very effectively against that variant. So when people come to me and say, I'm worried about variants, I tell them, well, get your vaccine. The next one. Some of the variants are concerning. The P1 variant, which is circulating in Brazil, has caused a significant outbreak in Brazil. And you can see at some point in time having an R naught of almost 5 as a result of that variant. This is how much more transmissible it was. The next one. You know, vaccinations, as Peter showed, I'm not gonna go into detail here, but again, you know, we need to get more vaccination, the next one, into many states. And also we need to step up the pace because it came down and it's staying around, you know, 1.6 to 1.7 million doses per day, where at some point in time, we were close to over 3 million doses per day. The next one. But overall, the picture for vaccines in our country looks good. This is the latest data. Almost 50% of the population has received at least one dose. And if you look at people over the age of 65, you know, 73, 74% are fully vaccinated. And that has been a big deal, right? Because 80% of deaths were occurring in people over the age of 65. So if you vaccinate them, deaths are gonna come down. The next one. One good thing that we're seeing is we're seeing the racial gap in US vaccination shrinking. I think there's been, from the administration, a clear focus on equity in vaccine distribution, and we're seeing that being addressed. The next one. And in fact, if you can look at the data here from CDC, you can look at by race ethnicity, having received at least, for example, one dose or even fully vaccinated, you're now seeing that in, for example, Hispanics is ahead of what the population is in that category. So we're actually doing better. So I think, you know, vaccine equity is not perfect, but it's getting better than it was at the beginning. The next one. Now, Peter talked about this, about the mask, you know, get off the mask as an incentive. The next one. I do want to remind people that masks are effective and they still work to limit transmission. And I still carry my mask and I still use it when I attend places where vaccinated and unvaccinated people mix. The next one. But we have seen an uptick in vaccine uptake. After the CDC guidelines recommending that fully vaccinated individuals don't need to wear a mask. And we've seen an increase in vaccinations as a result. The next one. And Peter showed this, how the states distribute. You know, we need to be sure that a lot of states are not at that 50%, right? And a lot of states are below that 50%. And again, we need to ensure that, as has been usually the case, it's the southern states where we have a lot of health disparities. We're seeing disparities in vaccination. The next one. The global vaccine equity is one that I'm very concerned about. The next one. And as Peter mentioned, we're almost seeing two pandemics, right? We're seeing epidemics fade away in cities that have vaccines, and we're seeing pandemics taking off in cities that don't have as much vaccine. The next one. You know, many of us are talking about what's gonna happen when COVID ends, and you know, COVID is not going to end. COVID is going to stay around with us for a long time. It's going to become more endemic in this country. And until we control it globally, we're really not going to have control of this pandemic. So with the National Academy of Medicine, I'm in charge of putting this webinar. And today we're having a webinar that is entitled, you know, Learning to Live with COVID-19. And we're going to be discussing some of these issues that I'm talking about is, you know, what's going to happen? Why do we need to continue vaccinating? For how long? How do we declare when the game is over? What are the changes that need to happen in our society? The next one. I want to end by stating that, you know, we were very pleased that Dr. Fauci gave the commencement address a few weeks ago here at Emory. And in his commencement address, he said, "Let us promise ourselves our memory of this tragic reality, that an infectious disease desperately killed people of color. This does not fade." And I think we need to make sure that we don't forget the tremendous impact this pandemic has had on Black and Brown communities and in minority communities. And we have to put, you know, addressing disparities, addressing health equity, and once and for all, trying to end health disparities in our country at the center of ending the COVID-19 pandemic. And with that, I'll end. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Del Rio, for your leadership nationally related to COVID-19. And we look forward to taking a look at the webinar later today. Our next, so now we will pivot into the second part of our program where we are highlighting our ABC COVID-19 awardees. As many of you might remember, last year in the midst of the pandemic, ABC awards related to COVID-19 and COVID-19 reduction in minority communities. And so we had our first three awardees present at our last webinar, and now we're excited to hear about the work of our last three awardees who were given awards. So our first presenter is going to be Dr. Hines, Anika Hines, who's an assistant professor in health behavior and policy at the Virginia Commonwealth University School of Medicine. She holds a PhD in public health and public policy from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, an MPH in health policy and administration from Yale University, and a bachelor's in science from Hampton University Honors College. She's a researcher focused on chronic stress within the context of neighborhoods and social environments as they relate to hypertension and heart disease risk with a health equity perspective. Today, and I just on a personal note, I have the pleasure of knowing Dr. Hines and helping to mentor Dr. Hines and listening to her wit, wisdom on a weekly basis. She's also a blogger for the American Heart Association and other entities as well. And so please check out her very prolific and informative work. So today, her award focuses on stress experiences of Black women during the COVID-19 pandemic, psychological and blood pressure outcomes. Dr. Hines.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Albert, for that kind introduction. And I benefit so much from your mentorship and continued support. And thank you again to the ABC for this Innovation Award. Today, I'm going to talk to you about stress coping among African-American women during the COVID-19 pandemic, both psychological and blood pressure outcomes. And I want to thank ABC for taking notice to this particular grant, because it's a little bit non-traditional when you think about the grand scheme of cardiology research. But I think it's a very interesting one that will indeed yield a very culturally relevant approach to addressing some of the disparities that we may see in cardiovascular disease within the context of the pandemic, while focusing on the African-American women who are a very important population in the grand context. So again, thank you again for supporting this work. And I'll begin next with a little background that most of you are probably, all of you I'm sure are aware of. It provides the backdrop for what we're doing and why I've selected the population, as well as the approach that we're undergoing in this work. So cardiovascular diseases kill nearly 50,000 African-American women annually. Of African-American women aged 20 and older, 49% have heart diseases. Only 1 in 5 African-American women believe she is personally at risk, and only 58% of African-American women are aware of the signs and symptoms of a heart attack, for example. In addition, 36% of African-American women know that heart disease is their greatest health risk, and this is all based on AHA data from their Go Red campaign. Next slide. And so when we were talking about disparities, these disparities in cardiovascular disease, chronic stress has actually been identified as a potential underlying factor and mechanism by which these potential disparities occur. And so what's been well documented is something that we call the weathering effect by Geronimus and colleagues. And if you look at this figure to the right, you see that Black women experience early health deterioration and consequence of cumulative impact of repeated exposures with social or economic adversity and political marginalization. And on the right, you see this figure that shows allostatic load, which is actually an index of a number of inflammatory biomarkers that shows that over time, over the life course, at every age point, African-American women or Black women have higher rates of stress compared to other populations. Could you click on a physiological level? Persistent high effort coping and acute and chronic stressors can have a profound effect on health. And that's what we're targeting in this work. In a very culturally tailored way. Next slide. And so as you can see, this is just a depiction of all of the multiple roles in social, in terms of their social status that African-American women play on their regular lives. And you see this kind of balancing act that's happening between either family concerns, being in the context of our neighborhoods and our communities, even within the context of our work environments. Next slide. And so with that in mind, last year before the pandemic, we actually launched during February 2020, which was both Black History Month as well as Women's Heart Health Month, Black Women's Hearts Paint Night, which was actually a program that provided a night of self-reflection and expression. You know, it's geared towards stress reduction. There's jazz music, and also we provided preventive heart education, including monitoring your blood pressure and understanding the importance of knowing your numbers. And so these are some of the works from that particular program. In which women and girls came together to create this artwork, and they found it to be, there were high ratings of satisfaction with this experience, and they actually wanted more. Next slide. And then the pandemic happened, and we were, socially distant and unable to convene in the paint environment again. As you all know, and as, the professors before me have already stated, we know there are significant racial and ethnic disparities with regards to COVID-19 infection, hospitalization, and death by race ethnicity, with African Americans leading in those categories. Next slide. And so when we're thinking about this, I think that Dr. Albert said perfectly, we're not just talking about a pandemic, we're talking about a syndemic, in which we're seeing both biological and social interactions coming together to create these exacerbated health inequities within the context of the pandemic. And there's this term that's often called the Black tax, in which, African Americans in particular, or marginalized groups in general, may bear the brunt. When system failures happen, marginalized groups often bear the brunt of those failures. And we saw that within the COVID-19 pandemic. And this photo is actually from an Atlantic article from a few years back called "Being Black in America Can Be Hazardous to your Health." Next slide. And so within that context, we saw a pandemic within a pandemic. So not only did we have COVID-19 happening, but there was also an uptick in, police violence. And of course, again, we remember George Floyd and his family, who on the anniversary of his death just yesterday, was kind of the prelude to a huge number of social protests and civil unrest within our country, and reignited kind of more talk about inequities, especially within the context of police violence. But more broadly, the COVID pandemic itself has raised more attention towards health inequalities. Next slide. So with that in mind, this idea of a syndemic, really brings us to social stress theory, in which an individual's background and associated social roles and status impact every phase of the stress experience, and includes the frequency and types of exposures, the mediators, their stress response, as well as their outcomes. And then value assigned to these experiences, in addition, may impact their coping, potentially inducing further psychological and physiological stress. Next slide. So in essence, the development of positive coping strategies may help us to blunt both the psychological as well as physiological effects of stress experiences. And that's the rationale for the work that I'm doing in this COVID Innovation Award. Next slide. So we really want to interrupt the cascade and focus more on primary prevention to the extent that we can, meaning that we want to prevent people from having high blood pressure if we can, or if they have high blood pressure, we want to do what we can to intervene in a secondary way in order to not allow that to progress to even higher. And when we can, include lifestyle modifications that could actually help them get into a normal range. So we are focusing on Black women, particularly who experience disproportionate levels of stress, who bear the burden of cardiovascular disease disparities, and in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic, occupy many of the frontline, essential, and critical infrastructure positions that were overly exposed in the beginning of the pandemic. Next slide. And so we introduce Art for Heart Paint Nights, which is a return of the paint nights that we did in 2020 before the pandemic, but in this context, we'll actually be collecting pilot data. So while providing spaces and tools for stress self-management and preventive heart care during the COVID pandemic, we will investigate stress experiences of Black women, and we will examine the change in both psychological and blood pressure outcomes from baseline to 4 months among participants in this programming. And we're doing this in conjunction with a community center, which is called the VCU Health Hub, which is a community self-expression space, gathering space that also has support of community health workers, and it is connected to a supermarket as well as a pharmacy. And so it's kind of, you know, thought to be a sort of opportunity for wraparound education and support for individuals with regards to management of chronic disease. Next slide. And so the overall logic model, you know, for the Arts for Hearts program, you know, includes a number of things. Who would have thought that a 2-page grant proposal would turn to a 40-page protocol? But there are a number of various inputs as well as measures that we will be collecting in order to build what we need in terms of understanding feasibility, acceptability, as well as preliminary efficacy of the various components of this work in order to inform a future trial. And so, you know, in terms of inputs, we'll have trained staff, educational materials, as well as guided training and blood pressure monitors. And we'll be doing a stress reduction activity. And following that stress reduction activity, there will be processing focus groups. And I'll tell you a little bit more in detail what those four sessions will entail, as well as heart health education that is supported by AHA, you know, resource materials on four different topics that I'll tell you about a little bit later. And then there's also blood pressure monitoring training. Not only will individuals participate in blood pressure monitoring before and after each of their on-site events, but they will be taught to self-monitor between weeks. And so we'll have, you know, an extraordinary amount of blood pressure data to try to assess the impact of the various components of the intervention, as well as, you know, kind of baseline and follow up the overall impact of the work. And so our short-term outcomes include awareness, knowledge, attitudes, as well as skills and self-efficacy. You know, and then we have our intermediate outcomes, which include psychological distress symptoms. So we'll be including some validated instruments of depression and anxiety. And also, you know, perceived stress, for example, positive lifestyle modifications. So we'll be also taking into account diet and physical exercise, physical activity, and then increased patient activation. So we really want to know if, you know, being engaged in this process and thinking more about, you know, your heart health will encourage individuals to utilize their care more, to engage with their providers, and additionally. And then there's blood pressure self-management. So use of the self-monitoring logs and so on, and the impacts, and hopefully we're hoping to see a lowering of blood pressure over time. And the long-term depressive symptoms, anxiety symptoms, and decreased blood pressure. I'll talk a little bit more about the instruments that we'll be using to measure these going forward. Now, there are a few assumptions that we're making in doing this work. One, we're assuming that painting is going to be effective stress reduction activity. Two, and we hope that participation in the heart health education will improve knowledge and attitudes, and that the curriculum is effective, and that the training are effective. So we're assuming that all these things are effective, and we are collecting data around each of those activities to see what their impacts are on individuals using a within subject comparison. And then in terms of external factors, there are also unpredictable life events and other hypertensive activities. For instance, maybe someone participates in a regular Zumba group, which is also why we've chosen this, you know, within subject before and after sort of approach. Next slide. And so the program components include painting. And so we'll actually use the artwork as a jumping point where participants will discuss their stress experiences through facilitated processing groups with the assistance of a social work colleague. And this will be 4 1.5-hour sessions over the course of the 4 months. There will be heart health education. We'll be using established resources. And we have a curriculum that centers around 4 topics. And those will be 1-hour sessions over the course of 1-hour sessions over the course of 4 months. And then there's this blood pressure monitoring, which is the most intensive part, which will include blood pressure assessed on site by a trained individual before and after each on-site activity. Again, we're doing small cohorts of about 5 to 8 individuals for each session. And then participants will be trained and provided with blood pressure cuffs for home monitoring. And they will do home monitoring in between on-site visits. Next slide. And so here's an overview, a layout of the 4-month intervention, just to give you an idea of how the paint sessions and the self-monitoring and education alternating happen. And so our first processing group will just be talking about coping during the COVID-19 pandemic. That will be their prompt for painting. The second processing group will be specifically about the experiences of Black women within the context of the pandemic. That will be their prompt. And then the third will include community experiences. And finally, Oh, the third will be family experiences, and the finally we'll look at community experiences. And education sessions include self-monitoring practices, stress management strategies, lifestyle modification, including diet and exercise, and then finally how to engage with your provider. And we are treating this within the context of the socio-ecological framework, where we have the individual in the center, surrounded by their family and the community, and then there's broader society. So really trying to contextualize an individual within the multiple layers of their interactions, knowing that they may be impacted by stress on those various layers. Next slide. So it's a 16-week single-arm pilot trial, and we're measuring feasibility, acceptability, as well as preliminary efficacy, including, you know, estimates of variability and within subject changes and perceived stress and cardiovascular outcomes, for example, of the stress reduction intervention. All sessions will take place at the VCU Health Hub at 25th. Again, this is this community gathering center that is easily accessible for the historic East End of the city, which is, you know, kind of a historically underserved, predominantly African-American community that has supremely high rates of hypertension. Participants includes individuals who self-identify as a woman, who self-identify as African-American or Black, and who are at least 18 years of age. And so we're gonna be recruiting 5 cohorts of about 8 participants for an N of about 40. And the recruitment will happen primarily through the VCU Health's Helps Community Board, which includes advertisement programs being offered at the center. And that's how we've advertised in the past, and we've been quite successful with that. Next question, next slide. And so we will have not only the survey data, which includes validated survey instruments on psychological stress, coping, knowledge, attitudes, and self-efficacy and lifestyle, but also our program records, which will include the participants' encounters with the program, you know, the attendance costs, on-site blood pressure measurements, as well as the participants' blood pressure logs that they'll be asked to keep. And finally, we'll have exit interviews in which individuals will be engaged about their experience with the program. We'll assess some satisfaction as well as, you know, kind of feasibility of the various tasks and barriers and facilitators to participation, as well as acceptability, appropriateness, overall satisfaction, and sustainability. Next slide. And so the main outcomes are depression, anxiety, health conditions. These will be self-reported, similar to the way that they would be asking in HIS, for example, blood pressure, you know, which will be measured on site by a trained technician, and then also blood pressure that they will be taught to measure based, you know, assessed using their automated cuffs that they'll be provided by the program. And these will be performed at baseline in 16 weeks, except for the blood pressure monitoring, self-monitoring, which will happen weekly. Next slide. And so, you know, as I mentioned before, you know, this pilot will provide a huge amount of data, and we will be, in order to control for lots of sort of extenuating circumstances that an individual might experience outside of the context of the particular site visit, we will perform within subject pre-post intervention scores on the outcomes to establish initial evidence of efficacy, with hopes of using that data to evaluate, you know, kind of the power needed for a future randomized trial. And, you know, also, you know, we'll be evaluating those changes to determine clinical significance of the changes observed. And then with regards to the qualitative data, including that from the processing groups, as well as the exit interviews, we will perform a content analysis, including, you know, discerning experiences of stress, symptoms, and coping, as well as themes that arise with regards to feasibility and acceptability and other aspects of implementation that would be useful to us as we move forward to design a bigger trial. Next slide. In terms of dissemination, because this is a community engaged work, we want to be ensured that we are not only disseminating the work to peer review publications and our scholarly outlets, but there are also opportunities and, you know, necessity to ensure that the community are aware of the results, including community presentations, infographics, as well as a community report back event that will include not only the participants, but the broader community, and handouts that we can also distribute through the Health Hub about the effectiveness of, you know, kind of stress reduction strategies on blood pressure and psychological outcomes, for example. Next slide. And so this work will increase our knowledge of stress experience of Black women during the COVID-19 pandemic, as well as psychological and blood pressure outcomes, and it may be used to inform a larger grant leveraging community partnerships to reduce racial and ethnic disparities in cardiovascular outcomes. Next slide. And so I just want to say that thank you to, again, ABC, as well as my co-partner in this, Dr. LaPrentice Brewer, Health Hub, as well as the lab, who have been supporting, you know, lots of the various components of this activity. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Hines. That looks like a wonderful project. Now, our next speaker is Dr. Kimar Joseph Brown. Dr. Brown is a clinical and research cardiovascular fellow at the Mass General Hospital and Harvard School of Public Health, Harvard Medical School. He is a John Laud Fellow in the Department of Genetics at Harvard Medical School, where his work focuses on understanding the transcriptional regulation of heart failure and cardiac fibrosis. The COVID-19 pandemic has magnified the digital divide, and Dr. Brown hopes that his work with his colleagues will aid in mitigating disparities in telemedicine access for marginalized groups with heart failure. His co-fellows, Dr. Jambi Mathenge and Dr. Daniela Kruselat, will be joining him for his presentation today. So we welcome you, Dr. Brown, Dr. Mathenge, and Dr. Kruselat, to talk about addressing disparities in ambulatory cardiovascular care during the coronavirus disease 2019 pandemic.
Thank you, Dr. Albert. And I should just say thank you, ABC, to the Association of Black Cardiologists for this wonderful opportunity and for leading the charge in advocacy for a diverse America. And good afternoon, everyone. My name is Kimar Joseph Brown. I'm a third-year cardiovascular fellow at Massachusetts General Hospital. And I'm excited to share our work entitled Social Determinants of Telemedicine Utilization in Cardiovascular Care During the COVID-19 Pandemic. This work was conducted in conjunction with my co-fellows, Dr. Jambi Mathenge, who you'll meet toward the end of the presentation, as well as Dr. Daniela Kruselat, who could not be here today, but is here in spirit. And this work is also championed by our PIs, Dr. Jag Singh and Ami Bhatt. And together we make up the MGH Cardiovascular Equity Task Force. Next slide. There are no disclosures today, so I'll jump right into the presentation. We know that inequality in healthcare is not a new problem. This is an ongoing issue that has had long impacts on marginalized communities and has long predated COVID-19 as well, especially when one takes a deep look at cardiovascular outcomes in minoritized groups. This we also know is inextricably associated with structural inadequacies, lack of opportunity, and just blatant discrimination. On top of that, Black, Hispanic, as well as Indigenous persons are more likely to live in larger multi-generational households and have essential jobs that cannot be performed remotely, such as transit, nursing, and construction, all posing a risk for higher exposure to the coronavirus. And taken together, this has not only led to higher incidence of infection, but greater hospitalization and mortality for Black and Hispanic patients alike. Next slide. So after the emergency declaration by Governor Baker here in Massachusetts back in March of 2020, we observed an exponential decline in in-person visits and a dramatic uptake of telemedicine in the ambulatory cardiovascular setting, especially during that first wave of the pandemic, as depicted here by the line graph in panel A. And what you're seeing in red is that there was this exponential decline in in-person visits, with blue and green representing telemedicine encounters via phone or video. This was consistent with national trends showing an aggressive rise in national telemedicine usage and a steady but elevated intra-pandemic plateau, highlighted here in panel B, in data analyzed by the Commonwealth Fund. Next slide. So as a clinician, I've had several personal encounters and experiences of patients with from specific vulnerable groups unable, completely unable to engage in telemedicine during the early phase of the pandemic and have listened to countless others talk about the same, especially in patients who are on domicile and patients who are elderly. And since the advent of digital health platforms, there have been several challenges to telemedicine use that are tied extremely closely to social determinants of health. These include lack of access to hardware, age, digital literacy, and outright distrust, which have essentially led our group to ask whether or not telemedicine is improving access or in fact widening pre-existing gaps in healthcare. Next slide. So the overarching goal of our project is to understand the predictors of telemedicine use and to utilize them to mitigate barriers. And as such, we're able to divide our work into three specific aims. Aim one involved the creation of the MGH Cardiology Telemedicine Registry, which is championed by our principal investigator, Ami Bhatt, and clinical research coordinator, Jackie Pagliaro, and is an ongoing repository of patients engaged with telemedicine at MGH Cardiology, allowing us to look at granular specifics of the platform, and as well as perform multiple comparative analyses. Next slide. So the registry is done. It's alive, it's active. And for purposes of today's talk, Dr. Mathenge and I will focus on aims 2 and 3, both revolving around understanding and mitigating those barriers to telemedicine use. After developing the telemedicine registry in aim 1, we sought to ascertain barriers to deficiencies in telemedicine delivery. And through this work, we highlighted several factors independently associated with lower utilization of telemedicine video visits in our cohort of cardiology outpatients at MGH. These included socioeconomic factors like public insurance, low household income, sociodemographic factors like Black race, Hispanic ethnicity, and age above 85. And one specific clinical factor stood out amongst the rest. That was heart failure with or without systolic dysfunction. This work was recently accepted to the European Heart Journal and is open for you to peruse at greater detail, but will be summarized here. Next slide. So in this study, we assessed 8,449 patients seen between March and June of 2020, a timeline overlapping with the first wave of the pandemic, and the infection control mandates issued here in Massachusetts. And out of the 8,449 patients, 86% were non-Hispanic white, so 86% were white, 42% were female, with a median age of 67 years. The figure here, or the cartoon here on the right, depicts the breakdown between in-person video and phone leads. Next slide. So in order to objectify socioeconomic status, we collected zip code linked median income for each medical record number and then computationally assessed average median household income for each encounter group, video, phone, and in-person. The bar graph on the left depicts average income for video, phone, and in-person groups respectively, demonstrating that there was a large gap between those who were seen by a video and those who were seen by in-person. This was almost a $16,000 or $20,000 gap. It made us just question what is going on here. Furthermore, we saw a trend toward those with private insurance having equal proportions of phone and video encounters, but a trend toward higher phone utilization and lower video utilization for those with public insurance, including Medicaid and Medicare, and then those who were uninsured, and that discrepancy got even wider for the uninsured group. Advance. So So taken together, this led to hypothesis one: patients with low socioeconomic status and carriers of public insurance have reduced access to telemedicine video visits. Next slide. So we then looked to see what were the groups with low median household income and what were the groups utilizing public insurance. And highlighted here in the red box are the non-Hispanic Black group and the Hispanic group having lower median household income compared to non-Hispanic White, non-Hispanic Asian, and other groups. Not only did we see a lower average median household income, but the dispersion from the mean was also less in these groups. So a larger percentage of these groups centered around that low median range. In addition to that, we saw greater odds of having Medicaid in both the non-Hispanic Black group and Hispanic group. And in the uninsured group, we also saw this a similar trend, although we did not have an end to meet statistical significance. Next slide. So this led to hypothesis two: Black and Hispanic patients are most vulnerable to reduced telemedicine access. Next slide. So we then developed a multivariate regression model to analyze the groups with low likelihood of telemedicine visit. This is particularly those seen by video. And data is summarized here in the forest plot on the left, showing several different things. And we actually assessed several factors, including age, sex, race, ethnicity, patient portal enrollment, insurance, median income above state average and below state average, as well as several cardiovascular comorbidities. And what we see here is age above 85 was associated with a dramatically lower odds of having a video visit, which we know is data that's already existing and quite intuitive as well. We saw no differences at the level of sex, but at the level of race, ethnicity, Black and Hispanic patients had a lower likelihood of a video encounter. Patient portal enrollment is, of course, absolutely essential. And those with patient portal enrollment had a very, very high odds of a video encounter. Those with public insurance, as detailed before, were also less likely to have a video encounter. Those with income less than state mean also had a lower likelihood of a video encounter. And then surprisingly, those with heart failure, regardless of their ejection fraction, had a lower likelihood of telemedicine video encounter. And this may play a role in a need for greater objectivity when assessing these patients. But there's still a question about why. Why is this population not having the video access that they want from there? And then one group stood out, which was the congenital population having a higher odds of video encounters. And I should shout out my PI Amibot, who is an adult congenital heart disease doctor, who is the champion of telemedicine and has had great uptake in her clinic for many years now. So that might be one reason why. Next slide. So we've addressed aim one, advance, and we've addressed aim two, figuring out what those barriers are and who those vulnerable groups are. And so we, in an attempt to develop an algorithm for delivery, as well as an algorithm for intervention, we are utilizing our registry to look specifically at the non-video population. Next slide. So Dr. Mathenge will now summarize the goals of the intervention arm, revolving mainly around evaluating the persistence of poor telemedicine access, addressing modifiable barriers, and implementing mitigation strategies all of which will allow us to engage in a sustainable manner. And the key word here is sustainable engagement. So Dr. Mathenge.
Thank you very much, Dr. Brown. It is my pleasure to be here with all of you to take you through our third aim in our project to develop an equitable telemedicine model for patients that we identified through the previous work that Dr. Brown has very eloquently described, allowed us to identify patients who are at particular risk of having unique barriers to access to telemedicine. So part of our intervention included three main steps. To one, identify the pre-identified risk factors that we have already mentioned. Second, to evaluate our mechanisms through which we can intervene on the identified barriers, including evaluating persistence of poor telemedicine access, not only at the start of the COVID-19 pandemic, but throughout this year as it has evolved, address modifiable patient-identified and system-based barriers to access for these patients, and implement digital health interventions, which I'll speak to in a little bit more detail. And third, engage patients in a sustainable telemedicine model in order to mitigate barriers and promote equity in digital health in our cardiovascular ambulatory care delivery. Next slide. So the reason that this is so important is that telemedicine is here to stay. And as Dr. Brown has eloquently mentioned, even in our own single center analysis, through the course of the pandemic and even to date, telemedicine and particularly video visits have been a mainstay as a significant proportion of telemedicine encounters in our ambulatory clinics. And despite multiple waves and late surges in cases, telemedicine visits have remained stable through the course of the pandemic. So improving equity and access to vulnerable patients is incredibly important. Next slide. So our intervention arm includes looking at three eligibility criteria. So one, looking at adults over the age of 18 years old who identify as having at least one telemedicine risk factor as we've identified in our prior analyses. And these can be grouped into three main groups: patients who self-identify as non-Hispanic, Black, and Hispanic, those with low socioeconomic status and with public insurance, and patients who are aged over 85 and who have completed at least one cardiology outpatient encounter during the COVID-19 pandemic from 2020 till this time. Next slide. And so our hypothesis is that barriers to telemedicine will likely differ for each of these aforementioned risk groups. And so we want to dig further and identify those specific barriers in these specific cohorts. Next slide. So taking study group A, for instance, which encompasses 428 patients who self-identify as non-Hispanic, Black, and Hispanic ethnicity, who, as in our prior study, are at higher risk of having limited access to telemedicine video encounters, we are administering telenow action surveys, which will allow us to garner patient-level data to assess knowledge and attitudes around telemedicine care, and also specifically assess patient-reported barriers to their own telemedicine access over the course of the pandemic, and specifically assess levels of access to hardware, including broadband and high-speed internet, and having access to tablets and phones that have video capabilities, in addition to assessing specifics with regard to digital literacy and language preferences in our patient cohorts. And by administering these surveys, we're able to garner modifiable factors that are patient reported, and specifically be able to mitigate barriers that we have identified, such as improving access to patient portal enrollment, improving access to hardware for patients that identify hardware access as their primary barrier to engaging in telemedicine, and understand the level of digital literacy in our patients in order to address that as a specific barrier as well. And so our implementation of telemedicine interventions will include assigning a telemedicine coach to each member of our study group, identifying virtual visit liaisons, and these can be individuals that are identified within the patient's family and community circles who can act as liaisons within their visit to help in connecting them to their visits on a consistent basis. And three, directly provide access to hardware for patients who identify hardware access as their main barrier to engaging in cardiovascular care in our cohort. Next slide. And so in specific addressing hardware access, we have secured tablets that were donated by the Mass General Disparities Solutions Center and the Center for Diversity and Inclusion in order to directly supply that need and mitigate hardware access as a specific barrier within our cohort of patients in this study. And furthermore, the incredible funding from the Association of Black Cardiologists Innovation Award will support the implementation of the aforementioned telemedicine interventions and also allow us to interrogate specific clinical outcomes for these patients in who are able to now consistently and sustainably engage in telemedicine and cardiovascular ambulatory care during this vulnerable time. Furthermore, through this work, as Dr. Brown mentioned, we established the MGH Cardiovascular Equity Task Force, which focuses on tackling inequity and bridging access to care within cardiology on a broader scale. And as we have highlighted, telemedicine is here to stay, and we're just so honored to be here to share this body of work with everyone here that is doing incredible work to help us make telemedicine and cardiovascular care equitable for all. Thank you very much for this opportunity. Next slide. We have so many people to thank, and I'll turn it back over to Dr. Brown to take us through the acknowledgements.
Right, and I'll try to be brief there. Thank you, Dr. McKinney, to start distributing some of these tablets. But I wanted to thank the members of the Cardiovascular Equity Task Force, the Center for Diversity and Inclusion, the Disparity Solution Center, and then most importantly, the ABC for amazing support and wonderful mentorship. Let's keep it going and see what we can do to help get access to folks who need it most.
Absolutely terrific work, terrific presentation. Thank you so much for being here today. And you know, I'm sure the audience has some exciting questions to ask you, and we look forward to your work, the results of your work. Next, we have none other than Dr. LaPrincess Brewer, who has been a staunch ABC member, heavily involved in our community programs committee and ABC and other efforts. Dr. LaPrincess Brewer is a cardiologist and assistant professor of medicine within the Mayo Department of Cardiovascular Medicine in Rochester, Minnesota. She's the first African-American woman cardiologist in the Mayo Clinic, Rochester staff. She earned her MD at George Washington University School of Medicine, MPH at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, and her bachelor's in science magna cum laude in chemical engineering from Howard University. She then did her internal medicine training at Johns Hopkins University and clinical fellowships in cardiovascular disease and preventive medicine at the Mayo Clinic. Her research focuses on addressing cardiovascular health disparities through community-based behavioral interventions for cardiovascular disease risk factor modification in vulnerable groups, especially African Americans. She's the recipient of the American Heart Association Harold Amos Medical Faculty Development Award, the NIH Building Interdisciplinary Research Careers in Women's Health Scholar Award, and an NIH KL2 Mentored Career Development Award. She's principal investigator of FAITH, Fostering African-American Improvement in Total Health Community Trial, a cardiovascular health promotion intervention in partnership within African-American churches. And I love this. She was recently named the 2019 Changemaker by Minnesota Public Health Radio News and the 2020 History Maker at Home by the cities of Minneapolis, both of which honored leaders making history in Minneapolis to commemorate Black History Month. And as you heard, Dr. Anika Hines mentioned that the project that Dr. Hines is involved in and that Dr. LaPrincess Brewer is also involved in. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce Dr. LaPrincess Brewer, who will be talking about COVID-19 emergency preparedness and risk communication among African-American churches, leveraging a community-based participatory research partnership. Dr. Brewer.
Thank you so much, Dr. Albert, for your kind introduction. And I'm truly blessed to have you as a mentor. I'm extremely honored and humbled as well to have the opportunity to speak today on our project funded by the Association of Black Cardiologists And this project has been a labor of love, and it has strengthened our community partnerships. So next slide, please. Disaster preparedness expert Stephen Siros reminds us that when disaster strikes, the time to prepare has passed. And the COVID-19 pandemic as a global public health crisis has truly taught us the importance of having a sound plan in place to act and respond to crises. And as a preventive cardiologist and health equity researcher, it is my aim to make sure that underserved and under-resourced populations are ready and prepared. Next slide, please. Unfortunately, the pandemic unveiled the disproportionate burden of health disparities among African Americans, and also that African Americans were disproportionately impacted compared to their representation in major cities across the country. Next slide, please. So, but at first glance, you know, Minnesota appears to be an exception to COVID-19 disparities. However, this thoughtful study unmasked the high COVID-19 and excess mortality sustained throughout the pandemic among Black Minnesotans. Next slide, please. And the Black church has not been immune to the devastating impact of the COVID-19 pandemic, as African Americans were also faced with a dueling pandemic of racial and social injustice. And this was ever present during the murder of Mr. George Floyd in Minneapolis in our own backyard. And while many churches were forced to close their doors, many were called upon through virtual means, if you will, as ongoing sanctuaries of psychological refuge to preserve the mental health of the African-American community. Advance. But that's not how the story will end. We sought to build upon the resiliency of Black churches to make sure that they are prepared for the next pandemic or disaster that comes our way. Next slide, please. So as Dr. Albert mentioned, I am the founding director of the Faith Cardiovascular Health and Wellness Program, and Faith stands for Fostering African American Improvement in Total Health. And it is the first community medical center partnership between Mayo Clinic and local African American churches for heart health promotion. And it's also the first community-based intervention using the American Heart Association Life Simple 7 framework in African Americans of high cardiovascular disease risk. Next slide, please. So in recognition of the disproportionate COVID-19 cases among African Americans here in Minnesota, we knew that we had to respond quickly. And we repurposed to focus on COVID-19 prevention in our partnering churches. Next slide, please. And we have a faith-specific community steering committee, which provides infrastructure for members to voice their priorities and preferences regarding faith's projects and interventions, which was established in 2017. And we jointly decided to establish a faith COVID-19 task force as a subcommittee of the Community Steering Committee last March to launch an emergency preparedness and risk communication initiative. And these are our members pictured here. All right, next slide. And we deployed an emergency preparedness strategy by providing the Preparing Your Church for Coronavirus Planning Manual, which was developed by the Humanitarian Disaster Institute to over 100 African-American churches within our network. And we also provided emergency preparedness starter kits from the American Red Cross. And we also launched a social marketing campaign on Facebook to share accurate COVID-19 information reaching an estimated of over 12,000 individuals. And we had a 30-fold increase in our reach, which was largely because of our outstanding community engagement by our communication leaders. And you can advance, please. This same week of May 2020, this week marks the anniversary, we saw a dramatic drop in use of our Facebook page, which corresponded directly to the horrific death of Mr. George Floyd in Minneapolis. Next slide, please. So displayed is a screenshot of our Facebook page showing material we co-developed in partnership with the ABC. And our campaign was run entirely by committed community members, including community health workers and a financial advisor. And our publication in Preventing Chronic Disease was ranked as one of the top 10 most talked about articles of 2020. And I must say, this is all because of our outstanding community partners and their devotion to their communities. Next slide, please. And we developed culturally tailored materials, including a flyer called The 10 Commandments for a Healthy Heart during the COVID-19 pandemic, which was widely distributed. Next slide. And we were honored to join forces with the Balm and Gilead Incorporated and our community partners at Essence Magazine to counteract much of the misinformation about COVID-19 being disseminated in communities of color. So you may remember at one point there was a myth going around that African Americans were somehow immune to COVID-19. Boy, was that wrong. So next slide, please. So we were so grateful to receive funding from the ABC to further our emergency preparedness sustainability plan. And based on our preliminary work, our next objective is to increase emergency preparedness and build post-COVID-19 pandemic resiliency within African American churches in Minnesota. Our aims are to identify gaps and needs of churches for emergency preparedness through a culturally tailored emergency preparedness capacity assessment tool. Advance, please. And our next aim is to use the information gathered from the emergency preparedness capacity assessment to provide customized guidelines to each church to facilitate their establishment of church emergency preparedness teams. Next slide. In integrating a community-based participatory research approach, we'll implement a four-tier strategy for emergency preparedness in partnership with African American churches. So each church will complete an emergency preparedness capacity assessment, which will identify gaps and needs in emergency preparedness. And we will then provide each church with a tailored emergency preparedness report or checklist. Advance, please. Emergency preparedness teams are at the heart of the initiative, and each church will receive a monetary incentive to establish or enhance their team with guidance from the report and checklist events. And each church will designate a prevention champion to lead the church emergency preparedness team and ensure that the materials and messaging are disseminated within their respective churches. Lastly, we are holding a webinar series, which will include sessions on emergency preparedness from national leaders and provide up-to-date COVID-19 information. And all sessions will be open to the community. Next slide, please. So we co-developed an emergency preparedness capacity assessment tool with our Faith COVID-19 task force, and it's called the Faith EP. And it assesses four evidence-based domains for emergency preparedness based on the CDC's crisis and emergency risk communication framework, which we use in our preliminary work. And these include establish emergency preparedness team or health ministry, communication strategy, collaborations and partnerships, and church and community outreach plan. And each church will complete a semi-structured interview, and we will formally validate the instrument as a tool for African American churches to have at their disposal to assess and ultimately enhance their emergency preparedness. Next slide, please. So this is the prototype of the emergency preparedness capacity report or checklist that each church will receive to provide them with personalized recommendations to enhance their emergency preparedness in the four emergency preparedness domains that I just mentioned. And it'll show room for growth and strengths. And this checklist will provide essentials for establishing their emergency preparedness teams. So next slide, please. And this is our project timeline, which includes an orientation session to provide an overview of the initiative and a primer on emergency preparedness. And we will then have a three series webinar to guide churches on equipping their emergency preparedness teams. And as a part of our dissemination plan, we will have a church-wide emergency preparedness showcase to share best practices and strategies for emergency preparedness from our partnering churches. And next slide. Our webinar series is titled Keep Calm and Be Prepared and features nationally recognized speakers from the religious and community sectors and academia, Bishop Latresa Jester delivered a superb word at our last first seminar last Saturday on the phases of disaster. Next slide, please. And we're also surveying parishioners from our partnering churches to assess the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on their social determinants of health and to assess their attitudes and opinions on vaccines. Next slide. And this is what we've accomplished thus far. We are recruiting from our Faith African American Church directory, which includes over 100 churches in Rochester and the Minneapolis-St. Paul area. And so far we've enrolled 20 churches and prevention champions and have a goal of reaching 30 churches. And we've had 40 respondents to our churchwide survey on the COVID-19 pandemic and hope to reach 150 respondents. And we held our orientation session in April in our first seminar last weekend with awesome attendance. And our emergency preparedness capacity assessment tool is now developed and currently undergoing pre-testing with our COVID-19 task force. Next slide, please. So finally, I would like to share recent media coverage of our initiative, which features one of our star church partners at New Creations Ministries in Minneapolis. Thank you.
Black doctors in Minnesota are working with local Black churches.
And Brandy Powell explains how this new partnership, spurred by the pandemic, aims to help all Minnesotans.
Lord, bless as never before, Lord. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we ask that you send a hedge of protection around us, Lord.
Senior Pastor Derek Granison of New Creations Ministries Church of God in Christ in Minneapolis and First Lady Brenda in prayer.
The Black church has been the centerpiece and is the institutional backbone of the African American community. And it's not only a place of salvation and refuge, but it's also a longstanding place of community outreach to its surrounding communities.
Mayo Clinic cardiologist Dr. LaPrincess Brewer is leading research efforts that address COVID-19 disparities in cases and outcomes among African Americans.
We knew that we had to act fast.
Dr. Brewer says Black Americans are nearly 3 times more likely to die from COVID-19 because of factors, she says, such as inadequate access to quality health care, residing in socioeconomically disadvantaged areas or working in service sector occupations.
We wanted to fulfill a need of emergency preparedness within African American churches.
A needs assessment survey indicated Black churches in Minnesota needed access to accurate COVID-19 health information. Dr. Brewer says her research team is utilizing the FAITH, or Fostering African American Improvement in Total Health program, to reach more than 12,000 church members from about 120 Black churches across the state through social media. The Granison says they've relied on that resource.
And New Creations Ministry is doing everything it can to keep people safe during COVID-19, including getting hand sanitizer and a temperature check before the parishioners go into the sanctuary.
Regarding a vaccine, 75% of research respondents said they didn't want to take the vaccine or were unsure. Brenda, who lost 3 relatives to COVID-19, says concerns include people with underlying health conditions. And
you're thinking back, and a lot of our ancestors and older people, they're thinking about the Tuskegee experiment, and there are other experiments that they've done on African Americans.
The Lord is my shepherd.
The Granisons pray the new health guidance from Dr. Brewer will help save their parishioners' lives.
Thank you. So we have a lot of work ahead of us, but we're excited to move forward. And, you know, we would like to thank the Association of Black Cardiologists for their support of our work, as well as our partnering churches and our Faith Community Steering Committee members. We appreciate the unwavering support of several entities here at Mayo Clinic, the Minnesota Department of Health, and the AHA Amos Award, and my mentors for their support of our work. Next slide. So just as a take-home point, remember to stay ready so that you don't have to get ready. Please follow me on Twitter at Dr. LaPrincess and Faith on Facebook at Faith for Heart. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Brewer. That was really amazing. And you, we all know, is at the forefront of CBPR work in our communities related to churches, putting our communities first. So thank you so much. For all the work that you and your colleagues do in a very academic and very strategic way that is so much appreciated. And we at ABC are thrilled to call you one of us, call all of you one of us. So here we are. Perhaps we should get everybody back on screen. I'm gonna close out. We're gonna probably take another 10 to 12 minutes. I want to start with a few questions for Peter. Is Peter still here? And Dr. Del Rios, are you still here? Looks like Dr. Del Rios probably had to drop off. Did Dr. Hong have to drop off too? Looks like they probably did. Okay, so I will then focus my questions and comments on the presentations by our COVID-19 awardees. And so the overriding or overarching theme of all of your presentations was a couple of things: putting patients and our communities first and focusing on improving the vitality, health, and access of our communities. And I love the term that that La Princess had at the end, keep calm and be prepared, are the thematic elements of all of your presentations. So for Dr. Hines, in your clinical trial, which you hope to develop after obtaining pilot data, are there any other outcomes or hypotheses do you intend to bake in from what you're already learning in your pilot work?
Yeah, there are so many different elements to this pilot. There are options to go in many directions, but of course, I would love to incorporate more biomarker measurement in a clinical trial, like considering allostatic load and some to help understand better those underlying mechanisms as it pertains to stress and high blood pressure in particular. But there are a number of different avenues, I think, and I'm hoping that we will also, not only with regards to, the outcomes of interest, but also explore more expressive approaches in context in terms of interventions for African Americans that might have impact on psychological and blood pressure outcomes.
And just as a quick follow-up question, you know I'm going to ask this question, is I know you're measuring perceived stress, but any plan to look at domain-specific stressors?
You said any...
Domain-specific stressors.
Domain, oh, you mean like, job or, all yeah. the... Yeah, yeah, we definitely, I take notes and I will tap on your shoulder for some of the instruments that you guys have, because we do have an opportunity to measure cumulative stress to more, have a better idea of more targeted interventions. For instance, if it's job stress or family stress or, various domains in that multi-armed woman that we saw in the beginning, the more targeted and more tailored we can become, I think the more effective we will be in impacting outcomes.
Thank you so much. And Dr. Brown and Dr. Muthingi, how are you guys doing? I'm thrilled that you guys have a publication already in European Heart Journal. Look, it was when you presented your data and the lowest group had an income of $88,000 and mean and the higher group $102,000, it strikes me that knowing that the, it's Massachusetts, but it strikes me that knowing that the average US income for African-American woman is about $32,000 and a male is probably about $36,000. So what, do you have any insights from your data that may come from 5% or 2.5% of the population that falls way below that 88,000 about their interfacement with telemedicine? The data you suggested implied that they probably would be doing more in-person visits, they probably would be on the phone, et cetera. But I'm curious to know if they actually don't even interface at all. I guess is the question.
Yes, absolutely. And that is such a great question. One of the things that we had to really battle with, knowing that Massachusetts is unique in some of its median income for a lot of families compared to the rest of the country and other regions. And so what we did see is that there was a lot of heterogeneity within that group who did receive in-person care. And there was a smaller group of individuals who had much lower a median household income, lower than the state average of about 55,000. And so those individuals were, even within the heterogeneity of the in-person group, were even less likely to have interacted with the healthcare system at all during that period of time. And so we recognize that that is definitely one of the unique factors of our cohort, that it might not be representative of the entire United States, but it did show that even within the structures of Massachusetts, knowing that there is a higher income level in order to, it's a more expensive state, there are a lot of other factors that go into it, that still there are a lot of vulnerable individuals within that group. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Dr. Brown, do you have anything else to add?
Yeah, absolutely. Sorry, I'm in a hotel room and my phone is going up. But the gradation that we see in income and its association with lack of video is quite striking. And I think when we pair that with certain clinical elements, specifically the heart failure group, which I'm absolutely interested in, we see that a lot of the heart failure patients were seen in person or were seen by telephone. And so I am highly interested in hearing some of these digital health platforms with heart failure, like CardioMEMS and other ways of remote monitoring. And if those barriers are present, then I think we're not going to be able to reach the groups that we need to reach. And we know that the incidence of heart failure is higher in Black males and Black females. And not only that, but the hospitalization and mortality is high in this group as well. So moving forward, that's one group that I want to really hone in on and target, because it looks like they in particular will have poor outcomes in the future if this persists.
Thank you. And Dr. Brewer, we know that you are very prolific on Twitter and social media platforms, and certainly no surprise that the Facebook outreach was one that is being effectively utilized. Can you tell us a little bit more about, you know, sort of how you measure the impact of that outreach beyond the numbers of persons who actually show up to the session?
Yes, fantastic question. Yeah, this is an emerging area of research in looking at what is meaningful engagement on social media and Twitter, and how is it truly having an impact on populations. So we estimated our engagement and reach by kind of number of hits, likes, responses, and things to post on our social media page. But we also took that one step further by having bi-directional communication with our communication leaders to better understand what the community members wanted to have posted or to hear about. And I think that's the true meaningful impact. If you know what they need or want and then post those and translate that to social media. So just to give an example, some of our churches said, you know what, we really don't understand or don't have resources for transitioning from face-to-face visits to online live streaming. Can you post information on how to do that? So we did that, and we got lots of posts. Another example last year was the CARES Act. They did not understand what the CARES Act meant, and it was very overwhelming, as you can imagine, to read through online information. So we had our financial advisor, actually do a short video, just breaking it down. What does it mean? How does that help your church and your community members? So I think you have to translate not only just kind of clicks and likes and posts, but also how is that having a meaningful impact on the community?
Thank you so much. And, you know, we have one question in the chat. I believe the question was intended for either Dr. Chin Hong or Dr. Carlos Del Rios. However, given that, for example, Dr. Mathenge's and Dr. Brung's presentation was on improving access, the person in the chat asks about disparities and basically having different identities. So persons with disparities being, you know, sort of at the marginalized, even within marginalized groups, and what we know about COVID. So one question I guess I would ask Dr. Mathenge and or Dr. Brown is any data about persons with disabilities and their ability to be able to access care and or via telemedicine or otherwise during the COVID pandemic that you're aware of?
Yeah, that's a very intriguing question. We haven't looked at that personally. And I would say there's a huge scarcity in data surrounding certain demographics who are absolutely even more vulnerable, like undomiciled, homeless patients, patients with disabilities who can't, right? Who are vision impaired or even hearing impaired. And there is a significant gap in one, resources and infrastructure to support those folks. But I think just a gap in research surrounding patients who have specific impairments. And so we need to do a better job. And I think that's something we want to really focus on in the future as well.
Thank you so much. And I see Dr. Chin Hong is now on our squares. Two questions for Dr. Chin Hong. Given that there is a lot of confusion and controversy related to schools and how schools will reopen at the college level, we know certainly at the medical school level, there've been discussions around that. What is your best guess and advice to educators related to the cadence of reopening of our schools?
Those are great questions. And I think it depends on which level of schooling you're looking at. So college age students have had access to the vaccines for a very long time. More than 400 colleges have said that they would make vaccines mandatory, which would make it a safer environment. Of course, it's sort of like splayed in different parts of the country in terms of which colleges are doing that. But it kind of hinges for some colleges on whether or not it's fully FDA cleared or not by then, because some colleges, even the University of California system, said they probably won't enforce it unless it's FDA cleared. It probably will happen by early fall, but that's what's happening in the college level. In the high school level, it's similar because their vaccines are generally have been rolled out. In the elementary school, I think that's really where a lot of the buzz is right now because their vaccines probably won't be ready. But I think that with teachers being vaccinated, ventilation being more emphasized, that it could be a relatively safe place and should be recommended given the risk benefit for that age group for regular school. In fact, New York, as you know, has pretty much said carte blanche, we are going to have these public schools open and didn't have an online option. Whether some states like Connecticut, et cetera, they're saying, okay, we'll still keep an online option open. So a lot of buzz, a lot of emotion around this topic. But right now in California, for example, if you were to open public schools fully with teachers vaccinated, ventilation, all of that, and some testing strategies in some schools, it should be generally safe given that the community prevalence is very low in California.
Great. And just two quick follow-up questions. And I know we're way over time, but one of the things we're going to do with this webinar is make it widely available on various media platforms to be able to increase the reach. So I want to get in a couple other things. So for Peter, again, you mentioned ventilation. There is the recommendation currently that, you know, fully vaccinated persons can eat indoors and outdoors. But we do know that there is great variability in ventilation in the indoor setting. What recommendations would you give as an infectious disease doctor about no mask and eating for fully vaccinated persons, indoor versus outdoors?
So there are three main variables to think about. First of all, I think, where are you? Are you in a place with still a lot of COVID? In the US, we're still seeing 30,000 new cases a day. So it's not gone away anyway. And there's a lot of variation around the country. So figure that. That's the first question. The second question is, are you part of a population that may not have as much of a response to the vaccine? So if you are immunocompromised in some populations within that heterogeneous group, you are probably 50% likely to have a spike antibody detected after full doses, two doses of vaccine. You may want to be more careful in that situation and be cautious if your community prevalence is high. And the third reason, the third variable is, of course, as you pointed out, Michelle, is the nature of what indoor means. If indoor means you're sitting next to a window, it's very different from being in a hole in a wall or an atmospheric bar, in which case it's going to be riskier for an unvaccinated or vaccinated person in a category like immunocompromised patients.
Thanks for that. And then the last question ties in some of the things you just mentioned and includes, you know, in the African-American community, there's a pretty high prevalence, as you pointed out, of lupus, for example, among African-American women. In a vaccinated, and we would encourage everybody, of course, to get vaccinated, in a vaccinated person with lupus, what would you tell them, given the three levels of advice you just gave related to their activities?
Yeah, so I think for the patient with lupus, I'll have them talk to their rheumatologist because not all biologics are the same. And there's so many of them that I can't really go through all of them. But there's very good data from rheumatology investigators showing that there's a, you know, range of proclivity or propensity to have a response based on what biologic you're on. So that's the first thing I'll do. The second thing, which is not our regular recommendation, but because there's so much uncertainty in the immunocompromised population, is you may also talk to your healthcare provider about whether or not a spike antibody test might be useful. Usually we don't recommend it, but for example, I had a friend who had a kidney transplant. She had lupus before. She ended up going to get her spike antibody test from a provider because she was really, really uncertain and fearful. And if she was negative, it wouldn't have changed anything because she still continued to protect herself. But she ended up being positive. So I think that ended up being giving her more confidence in sort of being like a regular vaccinated individual.
Awesome. Thank you guys so much for all of the terrific work you're doing, your engagement with the community in particular, your research. Just to summarize here today, I hope that our audience has learned a lot from your presentations today. We went through certainly vaccines, the global nature of our pandemic, which is something that we haven't as much focused on, and the importance of the fact that we actually live in one world, and the pull on one side is a tug on the other side, I think would be the important point there. And, you know, again, as we think about the murmurs, for COVID-19 in a diverse population. Again, all of our three COVID awardees actually spoke to these murmurs in Dr. Hines's presentation, which focused on stress experiences in Black women. The work is about how you make increase the resiliency of the group, while, you know, paying attention to all the needs, the emotional needs, the psychosocial needs, and you did talk about the education aspects of it as well. Dr. Joseph and Dr. Mathingi, your work on improving access related to telemedicine leverages, as it goes forward into the heart failure realm, devices as well as digital platforms, and that is commendable. Given that is exactly the direction that we would like to see particularly our UIM investigators moving. The Dr. Brewer, who has two projects here today, along with Dr. Hines, is a champion in CBPR work, particularly as it relates to the faith project with churches. And we at ABC applaud your work and are excited to look forward to the your customized interventions related to post-COVID-19 resiliency. So I want to, it's an honor to have been part of this program today. I want to thank our COVID-19 task force for the terrific work that the task force has done over this past year. I know that Dr. Narissa Hayes is still on the call today, who has been a task force member, Dr. Kevin Alexander, Dr. Peter Chin Hong, Dr. Alana Morris, and our task force team is supported by staff, Ms. Tiara Dillenberg and Mr. Alan Merritt. I additionally want to thank our CEO, Ms. Cassandra McCullough, for all of her efforts in supporting all activities in the ABC and certainly supporting me as well. The board chair, Dr. Elizabeth Afili. Also additionally want to thank Dr. Donald Ivey, Dr. Paul Underwood, Dr. Dennis Rimsky for their contributions as well. The final announcements that I have as we close out will be that to let our audience know that we are launching a COVID-19 vaccine information slide set that can be used in the community setting in order to inform our communities about the vaccines and to be able to answer common questions related to vaccine hesitancy and to COVID-19. Please visit us at abcardio.org next week to sign up to be able to access the slide set presentations. The final thing I want to say is that you've heard over the last two ABC webinars our COVID-19 awardees present their exciting work that we look forward to seeing the final results of. But I would say to this audience, this is going to be the first announcement of this, and this is the soft announcement of it, that please look for in the next few weeks an additional call for applications for our second set of COVID-19 awards. So thank you very much and be well. Please get vaccinated, get your friends, get everyone vaccinated. All our lives depend on each other's actions. Until we meet next, God bless.